Podcast is part of the Pod Syndicate family. For more criminally compelling shows, articles, and conversations, head to wearepodsyndicate.com.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to the Rewatch Project with Hannah and Mike. I am Mike, and with me, as always, is Hannah. How are you today, Hannah?
I'm well, thank you.
Go as far as saying capital.
Capital, yes, why not?
Let's go for capital. Do you know that this is episode 25 of the Rewatch Project? Yes.
It's now a quarter century.
Quarter century, yes. Or half 50, I think sounds more nonsensical, quite frankly.
A half century, yes.
So this week we are continuing on with season two of Marvel's Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. We are on episode 5, which is it A Hen in the Wolf House? Is that what it's called?
That is the one.
It's funny, I'd forgotten that there was an episode called that, and I remember the episodes quite well because I edit them, so I get to kind of experience them twice. And I remember referring to Grant in an earlier episode as a wolf in the hen house. Mm. So it's funny that they've done that because they know, and I remember this episode a little bit, so I know who they're talking about. They're not talking about Grant, obviously. But it's funny how S.H.I.E.L.D., it does reversals, doesn't it, of episode titles sometimes?
Yeah.
Like the end of the beginning and the beginning of the end and things like that. So I just thought that was a bit of an odd one. But
it's interesting you talk about listening back to the episodes because I too listen back to them.
But you just do it out of sheer vanity, don't you?
Yeah, basically, ego. But I just want to apologise to all the listeners because I think for the last two or three episodes I've said that this is the point that the team have all come together in the second season, and it's like, shut up, Hannah. They are all a team now. Just let it go.
It's an evolution, isn't it?
I know, but I've literally made the same comment.
Well, I mean, you know, the night's still young, Hannah.
It's like I don't remember what I said the last time.
Before we get into talking about this week's episode anymore, I just want to do a quick bit of housekeeping and just remind everybody of the various ways that they can reach us and some other little bits and pieces that I'd like to, as I used to say on Chin Stroker versus Spencer back in the days, a little bit of gentle plugging.
Nothing like a gentle plug on a Friday night.
You know, particularly when you're a beginner. Indeed. When you're only 25 episodes in, you know. Yeah,
you only want it to be a gentle plug.
Yeah, no, you're still on the sort of the training plugs at this point, aren't you? So we can be found on Twitter at rewatchproj. And it's been quite nice as well because I've been sort of, whenever I post the episode, I always sort of very solicitously include the writers and directors in there, and there's been a couple of points where they've gone, oh, thank you, and I'm just like, woohoo.
And that's when he texts me and goes, guess who just liked our tweet?
What are you talking about? I play it cool.
Oh, yeah, you're
I didn't
so
even notice.
Cool.
Hey, people have responded. I wouldn't know. So you can find us on Twitter at rewatchproj. That's rewatch, P-R-O-J. And you can email us at rewatchprojectpodcast@gmail.com. And also, as I like to remind you guys, we are part of the Pod Syndicate podcast, blogging, YouTube, all manner of things network. So go over there to wearepodsyndicate.com, find other shows such as my other show, Chin Stroker versus Punter, but also Beyond the Neon, Film Rant, Film Bastards, The Iron Sequel,
Entertainment Landfill. They've had a new episode out.
Yes, they have, I noticed. So go and check all of those out. And also check out the bonus shows.
His film, Her Movie.
Mm-hmm. And I've noticed Noel's just added a written piece in the fan creator series that I've been doing a few videos for as well recently. So there's loads of good stuff over there. So go and check it out. You'll probably be familiar with some of the shows from the promos that we play in the breaks on this episode. And this episode will be no different. So that will give you a bit of a sample of what is going on over there. We have had an email. So speaking of which, we have had an email come through to rewatchprojectpodcast@gmail.com. I'm just going to bring that up now and pass that over to Hannah, who has a much more pleasant reading voice than I. So where are we? So there we go, rewatchprojectpodcast@gmail.com. And it's the top one there, Hannah. So if you could do the honours.
Okay. This is entitled, Hello.
Hello.
Hello. Hi, Hannah and Mike. Millie in Toronto here. Big fan of your show and doing a rewatch of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. along with you both. I was curious, what are your general viewing habits? Do you tend to watch a lot of TV or mainly films? Also, I hear you mention you have kids, as do I. Do you curate what your kids watch or let them lead? Keep up the good work, Millie.
Okay, so a bit of stuff about viewing habits beyond Marvel's Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. So, Hannah, what are you?
Well, firstly, thank you for your email, Millie.
Yes, it's lovely
to hear that people are listening along and enjoying it.
Let's de-anonymise our listenership.
Indeed. So, aside from Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., I think we watch a pretty healthy mix of TV and film.
Yeah.
We certainly have our shows that are staple for us. We're very uncouth. We don't eat tea at the table. We usually eat it watching TV.
Mm-hmm.
So we're definitely not film watchers while we're having dinner or whatever.
It's a weird thing, actually, because Hannah used to make fun of me for this. This is more sort of guided
by Mike.
Yeah.
But yeah.
I'll give you an example. Like, so when we... I like food.
I like to eat, my darling.
And I like to give it my full attention. I like films, and I like to give them my full attention. So I'm more of a, if we're going to have the TV on while we're eating, which we do more often than not, I'd rather have a sitcom or, MasterChef, or just, you know, something that doesn't require a huge amount of... So, because when I watch a film or a TV show that I'm invested in, I want to be able to give it my full attention.
Because he can't eat and watch something at the same time.
No, absolutely. I'm not saying that it's the only way to do it.
And this is what I tease him about all the time, that chewing and paying attention is apparently too tricky.
Yeah, I don't know. It's a weird thing, I know, but that's... I'm not alone, though. I know other people who are like that.
Okay, but to go back to what we watch too. So we tend to watch a sitcom sort of earlier on in the evening, and at the moment that's The Goldbergs.
Yeah.
So we're up to season 5.
Or we throw on like just an old episode of Friends or
Schitt's Creek.
Yeah, just something that is familiar. And,
yeah.
And I think it's interesting. I think what that also ties into is the fact that I think that if you've got kids, particularly young kids, that has a huge impact on what you watch. Not just obviously having to watch a lot of stuff that they want to watch, but also just the fact that you've got less time. And I think that it can sand the edges off what you watch a little bit. I think that when you've got kids, again, particularly young kids, you don't want to watch stuff that's too challenging because it's just a bit depressing, you know. And
I think when they first go to bed, you need to almost decompress and just watch something that washes over you.
You'll have been working all day, and then you have time with your kids. So really, you know, after that, you don't want to sit down and watch an episode of The Wire.
No.
You know?
Once we've kind of decompressed, there are TV shows that we watch. I mean, obviously, the new Marvel TV shows we're watching. We've watched WandaVision.
A lot of genre stuff, really.
Lots of sci-fi. Okay, so some of the TV shows we've watched recently. I'm a huge fan of Schitt's Creek, so I've watched that multiple times. Yeah. We've watched WandaVision, Fargo, the Watchmen TV series, obviously Star Trek Discovery.
Yeah.
What else have we watched? The Orville.
Yeah.
We did a massive sci-fi rewatch and did Babylon 5, all of Star Trek Next Generation, Deep Space Nine, Enterprise.
Basically, we're at a point in our lives, and I think that this will change at some point, but we'll always be there, where it's a lot of comfort watching.
Mm.
And I think that that's not unusual to be loved by anyone. I think it's having, when you've got kids as well, is the fact that you kind of want to... there's a lot of stress and there's a lot of anxiety and there's a lot of fear in your life, I think, if you're a parent.
Yeah.
And I think that what you want is you want things that kind of show you that the world...
It's all
going to be okay. And I think that shows and films that have a heroic arc become very appealing at that point. You know?
And certainly from a personal point of view, in terms of film viewing, and we do, like, we absolutely do go through stages of watching more films over TV, just depending on what's out and what we fancy.
And documentaries as well, obviously.
Yeah, but, like, what I was about to say is, personally, I've been more inclined to want to watch older films at the moment and very specific genres, like sort of late 80s, early 90s action films or crime caper films, like whodunit, sort of like not Ocean's 11, but those types of something's happening, but really something else is happening at the same time. Yeah. That's sort of where my head's at. And my film viewing is very much connected to where I am emotionally. So
it's mood dictated.
It very much is. And there are some times where I just can't get my head around watching a film, and that's when I tend to burn through a whole lot of TV.
Well, sometimes one... just, and I'm not being facetious when I say one, I'm just, because I've, this is a general thing that you could apply to. I think we go through phases about how much we want to be challenged by what we're watching, but also attention span.
Yeah.
You know, how much attention you want to give. I mean, I'd say that the other thing as well, but two other things as well I mentioned very briefly are, we, Hannah and I go through these weird theme tunnels where,
very much so.
You know, like we'll watch a film by a filmmaker like Guy Ritchie. We watched a Guy Ritchie film that we enjoyed. So then
we watched The Gentleman.
So then we went on through loads of Guy Ritchie films. We then watched all of the Rocky and the Creed movies, and you know, after Tarantino, we did all the Tarantino films. And also, this, obviously, being human beings, the stuff that Hannah likes that I don't like, and vice versa. So I have things where if Hannah goes away for a few days with the kids to visit family, I will then. I kind of build up a backlog of stuff that I know Hannah wouldn't want to watch.
Yeah.
And generally, that's either horror or sort of somewhat more, I guess, transgressive films, you could say, or a lot of much older stuff, like black and white old kind of films, which...
Some black and white stuff I love, but I have to be in the right frame of mind for it.
So, for example, there'll be a lot of... I mean, Christ, this will give you a bit of a sense of the sort of diversity of this, is I've been working, like, if Hannah's away for half an hour, I'll put on half an hour of something, and then I'll pick up on it, like on Plex or on whatever. I've been working through some classic Doris Day movies from the early 50s.
Much
recently.
To our daughter's disgust.
Yeah, so, you know, and I know that that is an era and a temperament that doesn't have any appeal to Hannah, so I'll sort of watch those. So there's all the stuff that a lot of the stuff that we've just discussed is basically where our Venn diagrams cross.
Yeah.
You know, we both like that genre, action adventure, classic 80s, 90s, sci-fi, fantasy, action adventure, comedies, all, you know, that kind of real, you know, the sort of cheeseburgers, so to speak. There is stuff on the other side of the Venn diagram that obviously, you know...
So, like, the stuff I watch that isn't really up Mike's street so much is anything true crime-related. Like, I'm very much... Like, I love a documentary about a true crime.
Yeah.
Whereas Mike isn't so into them. And I am... And I have been for a while. I've been obsessed with everything related to rock climbing. And I say this coming from it as a person who cannot climb one inch of a rock, but I know a lot about rock climbing because I've gone down this massive tunnel of documentaries and books and
what you
all
respond
kinds
to, though, is though the triumph over adversity sort of element of it. And, you know, I mean, it's a metaphor. People are like, oh, you know, I really had to climb a mountain to achieve this thing, you know. And I think that a lot of that comes from watching, was it the, what was the Coldwell one that you watched?
The Dawn Wall.
The Dawn Wall, and then obviously Free Solo and the Real Rock kind of shows and all that kind of stuff. What about this question about kids, our kids viewing? Like, do we curate them or?
Well, from my point of view, I think when they were a lot younger, our kids are nearly 5 and nearly 7. So when they were maybe two, it was much easier to curate what they watched because, you know,
we could control it.
Yeah, they couldn't work the remote.
We still can, but
We got both of the kids really into film very early, didn't we? Yeah. So our daughter, her favourites when she was sort of a year, 18 months too, were Finding Nemo, Toy Story.
Moana.
Yeah, that's when she was three. But yeah, Moana, that kind of thing. So all the like standard Pixar and Disney films, Frozen, all that kind of thing. Our son, the first thing he got really into was Toy Story 2 specifically.
Yeah.
And then we finally got him to watch the first one and he was just like a Buzz Lightyear obsessive and still is extremely attached to Buzz. And that's why I
think he likes the second one because the second one's very Buzz, he's very Buzz-centric.
Well, it starts with Buzz flying in from space and he just thought that was the best thing ever. He then got very attached to Maui and Moana. Yeah,
Boss Baby.
And Boss Baby. Yep, he gets very attached to certain things in films.
What Philip likes is he's a really big fan of the punch the air moment. Moment in a film where, usually towards the climax of the film, where there's a swell of music and a moment of transcendent victory from a character, he gets very swept up in that.
As an example of that, in Boss Baby, when, you know, spoiler alert, when the baby gets the beads from the older brother and realises that they're his love and all this kind of thing, and he throws them up in the air and it's all wonderful, Philip would out loud go, yay, and clap and just be so excited about it.
And it's like, I think he doesn't even, and it's one of the great things about film as an art form, is he didn't, at least certainly at the beginning, on any understand intellectually what's happening within the narrative of the film. It's just the image and the feeling of it was appealing. But I mean, obviously now Philip's big thing is superheroes. He's all about
very much into superheroes. Both of the kids went through that terrible phase where, like, we couldn't curate anything, and Mike and I, it was torture the amount of times we had to watch PJ effing Mask.
Well, that's the other thing, is as far as the whole curating thing goes,
and Paw Patrol.
The only time I've tried to do that is, I mean, I'm a big Star Wars geek, and every so often I'll try and put it on for Philip, but I'm not one of those people where, it's not like people, guys who try and push their favourite sports team onto their kids.
No.
You know, I'm not, as long as he's not just watching YouTube all the time, I don't care.
Mm.
And for me, it's more, I just like to, the only curating I do is as much as possible trying to push them away from like empty calories. Because with things like PJ Masks, it's just crap.
It's just dull.
That's the thing. Yeah. I mean, it's got good, nice colours, and I get there's pleasing character designs, but I just think that there's, and I don't mean this in a snobby way, there's better stuff that does that, and stuff that is teaching morality lessons and has some kind of,
I mean, they went through their phase with Marsha and the Bear, and
but that's quality. That's what it's made.
It's fine. You know? And Miraculous Ladybug. Oh my God, the amount of times that we've had to watch
But I suppose the other thing, the other element here as well is that there is a selfish element, is the fact that you know that if your kids get into something, that you're going to have to watch it a million times. So it better be something that you're going to not object to hugely. So, for example, I sat down with Chloe and watched Raya and the Last Dragon, the new Disney film, because I knew that being Disney animation, that it was going to be good, and that if she was going to get into a new thing, that's probably going to be something that's going to be, have a good lesson to it that can lead to conversations about things. And also, I know that it's going to be artistically, what's the word I'm looking for? Satisfying to me if I do end up having to watch it 500 times.
I think the thing with both of our kids is that, and I'm sure you'll agree with me, is when they get into something, they go deep.
Yeah.
They, like, when Chloe got into Miraculous Ladybug, she eats, slept, and breathed it. Like,
and Chloe wants
all
to
she
know,
wanted to do was have a yo-yo and jump off things all the time.
And Chloe kind of wants to know how these things are made as well. Like, she was asking me what a director was and stuff like that.
She was asking me what a movie trailer was today.
Yeah.
And, you know, she's been through the phase of My Little Pony. I think the biggest thing is that we try and make sure that the stuff they're watching isn't harmful to them, I suppose.
Yeah, I mean, that's the bottom line.
Emotionally.
Yeah, I mean, the one thing that bothers me a little bit is, and I know this, and I still let them watch it because I'm a lazy parent and sometimes I just don't have the energy to fight them. But a lot of it is just designed for, like, Chloe will finish watching something and she'll be like, oh, Dad, these toys are only available at Kmart. And I'm just like, and when she says things like that, I'm like, shit, that's not great parenting on my part. The fact that she knows like which chain stores to get them, and you know,
she is fully obsessed with shopping though.
Yeah,
so
So I think that's the thing, is the fact. I mean, I think the bottom line, as far as curating goes, the first thing is for them, as you say, not watch anything that's harmful, and to try and minimise the amount of stuff that they're watching, which is just teaching them how to consume.
Yeah,
and also just try and make sure that if there's something that they're watching that's crap, if there is a better made, more version that has more kind of calories to it that we can point them towards. But if they decide that they want to continue watching this crap thing, hey, everything's subjective.
I sort of feel like we're doing okay so far, because when they're tired and grumpy and want to watch some comfort viewing, our daughter's comfort viewing is either Barbie or a film, and our son's comfort viewing is Bluey or Toy Story.
Yeah.
So
we could do a lot worse. Okay, well,
absolutely.
What we're going to do now, guys, is we will take a short break, and then we will come back and we will do the non-spoiler discussion of A Hen in the Wolf House. That's episode 5 of season 2 of Marvel's Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. And then after that, we will give you plenty of warning before coming back and doing the spoiler section. Before we break, would you like to tell us, Hannah, who created this episode?
Just about to say, we have seriously neglected...
No, we haven't.
That's... Okay, fine. So, this was aired on the 21st of October 2014, written by Brent Fletcher.
Awesome, okay. So, Brent Fletcher's written a bunch of episodes already, I believe. Yep. I don't recognise the director, actually. I think they've maybe done less.
Director of Dexter, The Americans, Batwoman TV show.
Okay, yeah, that's a WB thing.
Just trying to see if there's anything else. Some X-Files. Yeah.
Cool, all right.
That sort of stuff.
We will press pause now and watch the episode, and then we will be right back.
Have you ever wondered what so-called family films will scar your kids forever?
Putting 4 and 5-year-olds in front of this movie, it's like, if they didn't know what death was before this, they're going to know it after it.
They're going to know it after it, and they're going to be freaking terrified.
And they're going to be questioning you.
Yeah.
Or do you have the slight suspicion that your loved one has a cold, dead heart?
Yeah, The Dark Knight has got like all the orphans, and like, oh no, we're going to die. They did not build up those orphans at all. In my head, it's like, kill them.
Then look no further. The His Film Her Movie podcast is the show for you. It's the movie podcast that celebrates the contrasting cinematic tastes of its hosts. So join Jordan and Lauren every week on their unique journey through the land of the silver screen. So if you're looking for a few laughs, some fun film-related chat, then get involved. You can find us on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Stitcher, or wherever you get your podcasts.
Okay, so welcome back, everybody. And that was episode 5 of season 2 of Marvel's Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. That was A Hen in the Wolf House. So, yes, so we've just finished watching that, and we will do a little bit of, initially at least, in fact, a fair old bit, I dare say, of non-spoiler stuff, and then we'll do a little spoiler section at the end if there's anything that we have for that. But yes, Hannah, initial impressions of this episode.
This was a really fun watch. I'd forgotten how much humour was in this episode, and although it's dense in terms of where the story goes and the elements that it tells you about and moves forward, it's done with a surprisingly light touch, and I really enjoyed it.
Yeah.
What about you?
Same. I mean, this is one of those ones as well where, and I guess this kind of cuts to the very sort of core of the concept of this podcast, is this was one of those ones that was very interesting. I mean, I remember enjoying it the first time. But it feels very much like an interesting one to rewatch.
Yeah.
And I'm sure that we'll get into that. But yes, I mean, there's elements of this that, I mean, people who have been spoiled and have been listening to the spoiler sections will, I won't get into it too much now because we will work our way through the episode, but there are, were a couple of things in the spoiler sections that we were talking about, how, oh, when is this going to happen? When's that going to happen? And there's a little bit of that going on here where it's like, oh, okay, I guess this is where, you know, these things are introduced. So, yeah, should we just get straight into it? Because like you say, it's quite a dense episode, this one. So I think that more than ever, this is one that benefits from sort of just going through the episode, I guess.
And I think it's sort of good to note that this is just the direction Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. goes in. It's dense. There's a lot to take in.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I mean, it's funny. I mean,
and that's no spoiler. That's just, you know, their stories, as time goes on, they become more complex, more intricate.
Well, it's you're absolutely right, and I agree. But it's almost not just that, because I noticed this episode that they get through the exposition really fast. Mm. Like, they do the classic sort of Aaron Sorkin kind of walk and talk.
Yeah,
but they burn through it. It's like, you know, you know how, like, after the opening credits, you've got always got that sort of 2 or 3 minutes on a TV episode where you've got the sort of the remaining titles sort of going over the initial scenes. They always just throw a lot of stuff at you at that point.
Mm.
And that's the point in the episode where audiences are catching their breath after the beginning bit. And it's really easy to miss stuff at that point, you know. Yeah. And that's not a criticism as much as just...
No, they just hit the ground running.
Yeah, it shows a lot of faith in the audience, I guess, is what I'm saying.
But, I mean, that's... Like, I sort of feel like they treat their audiences with some intelligence, and they don't really spoon feed you anything. Like, and we've said before about how, you know, we've watched a season and then come back for the following season and been like, oh God, what happened? You know, because they expect you to keep up and they don't give you a previously on.
Well, they don't have characters saying dumb things like, as you well know, .. You know, they kind of...
As brother from my sister's mother said...
Don't get me wrong, there's times I wish they would.
Yeah, totally.
Particularly when we were watching the episodes in real time.
Yeah.
But, okay, well, the episode opens up with a wedding with a large, what seems like Navy contingent there. And
I thought it was a very Fringe opening, a Fringe style opening, you know.
You mean an X-Files opening?
Fringe.
So we see the wedding guests take a drink and they all get that weird ashy faced thing going on that we've seen several times before. We see the our beloved Brit Heel gets an update on it for Whitehall. And we learned that they've wiped out essentially an anti-Hydra unit.
Yep.
And so that's what's going on there. And this is a scene. I've actually got a note here where I've written fast exposition, where, you know, you've got the walk and talk, and they're just burning through exposition. And it's funny because I think part of it is just the fact that exposition is a necessary evil, and I suppose why not get through it as quickly as possible, because it can make a narrative just sort of die on its ass.
And although it's important to know that they are trying to manufacture this technology, and that's, you know, one of their nefarious plans, the whole opening scene of the people dying at the wedding and it being because they've drunk the thing, it's kind of irrelevant to the rest of the episode. It's not, they're not trying to find out what it was that killed them, like, you know, it's not the team mobilising to stop
that happening. Yeah, that's not the narrative drive of
It's really just a jumping off point for the episode, and a way to sort of frame where they go in terms of getting into the Hydra lab.
Yeah. I mean, those pre-credit sequences often are just them sort of the show setting up its stall.
I think that's a big difference from the first season where, you know, your opening credits kind of signify what the team is about to try and achieve.
Well, it's that, that's what this week's case is.
Yeah, but if this had been the first season, they would have been stopping that particular thing from happening within the hour episode. Yeah,
they'd have been dusting for prints at the wedding, kind of.
And that's the same in Fringe. Like, the first season of Fringe is very much a, this is our objective. We will fulfil that objective by the end. Plus, there'll be a teaser of something that might happen in the next episode.
We might get a couple of little scraps. You know, you might catch sight of an observer or, you know, all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
We see that Sky catches a glimpse of the hieroglyphs on Coulson's desk when she goes in for a meeting, because he's still very much kind of, there's still the weird distance that's going on. Well, not weird to us as the audience, because we know that there's a little bit of secret business going on.
Yeah. She's just aware that he's not behaving exactly like she expects him to behave.
Yes, sort of, you know, paternal team player. Coulson chews Sky out about her questioning him, and May warns him that it won't end well.
Yeah.
And I think what she kind of, the implication of what she means by that is that he's pushing Sky away, and that's not a good thing.
Well, she knows that by pushing Sky away, all it does is make Sky more interested in finding out what the thing is. Like,
well, it's
rather than Sky going, I best leave that. He obviously doesn't want me to know.
It's like a
classic male versus female thing, I think.
Well, no, also it's a don't press the red button. It's like I always think of that great bit in The Simpsons where Ralph finds his dad Chief Wiggum's gun, and he's like, how did it happen? And Chief Wiggum's like, I don't know. He's like, I don't understand what his endless fascination is with my forbidden cupboard of mystery. It's like it's just an enticement almost.
Yeah.
So we see Carl McLachlan's character and Raina. She's begging him for the obelisk because, you know, as you may recall from previously on Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., that basically
Dr. Whitepool's put the shits up her.
Yes, absolutely. You see that he loses control, and there's this kind of weird theme of like almost hulkish anger management going on with his character. And he loses control and says that he's going to put his family back together again, and it's all very creepy, kind of Jekyll and Hyde-y kind of.
I kind of like the fact that they don't really show him hulking out, quote marks, because, like, as much as I love Kyle MacLachlan, I don't really think he's the super action hero. So to see him go uber...
No, he's a character actor. I mean, he's...
uber action would just be wrong.
So to
leave a bit of mystery, it's a bit like how they didn't show Jaws for a long time in Jaws.
Yeah, absolutely. There's a very important moment when Raina mentions Sky and he says, that's not her name.
Yep.
And then we go back to Simmons being undercover at Hydra. We go back to the workplace drama of Simmons in the Hydra office. And she's invited into a meeting with Daniel Whitehall, who, you know, he's kind of this mythical figure. You know, his name's kind of whispered. It reminds me a lot of the stuff that happens with Hydra, of Wolfram and Hart in Angel. Yeah. You know, like, oh, careful you don't get called up to the senior partners and all that. It feels like they're playing in that kind of sandbox a little bit here, where it's like a workplace drama, but, you know, if you'll get killed, you won't get fired, you know. It's like Suits, but with demons. And they talk about the alien artifacts, and basically what's becoming really clear here is that Whitehall's sort of end game here is he wants to figure out how to successfully weaponize the obelisk. And all of these experiments that you're seeing have got like the self-serving agenda of taking out, you know, people who are like anti-Hydra agents, but ultimately they're just useful two birds with one stone guinea pigs for this weaponization. And it's classic stuff. I've said to you before about how there's a big Indiana Jones influence running through Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. And this is very much the Nazis are looking for the Ark of the Covenant so they can have ultimate power kind of feeling. We get another sort of couple of scenes with Fitz and, you know, Head Simmons. And there's a great bit of sort of almost Homer eroticism where Simmons is leching over Mac. But as she points out, she's like, dude, this is you, you know.
Well, no, he points it out. He says, because you're my subconscious, I mean, of course I'm going to agree with you.
So we get, it's funny actually, because we may as well mention this here, even though it hasn't got to this point in the episode yet. One of the things I was alluding to was Hannah and I were trying to remember when Hunter's X came back into it. because we both got a sort of faulty memory that they debuted at the same point at the beginning of season two, when in fact they didn't.
And I'd forgotten that she'd come in as a, quote marks, bad guy to start with.
And like, I didn't realise that this was the episode where she was introduced. I obviously just didn't catch her name in the credits.
Mm.
And
I knew she was coming in, but only because I specifically sought it out. But like when she came onto the screen, I was surprised because I forgot that she was undercover.
Yeah, well, when we would have watched this episode for the first time, we wouldn't have known. We'd have
just been 7 years ago that we watched it.
Yeah, yeah, but we wouldn't have known when we first watched
it.
No. And it's funny, but the reason I'm mentioning it now is that in my notes, which obviously I wrote chronologically as we were watching the episode, I wrote, oh, and now we get this week's reference to Hunter's ex, because one of the things that Hannah and I have been saying in the spoiler section, which we can now reveal to you know, you civilians, is that we knew that Hunter's ex was going to come into the show, and we were kind of joking about how sort of persistent and on the nose... Because initially, I think when you first watch the show, you think it's just a classic, you know, like...
Just sort of bent.
Yeah, like Bruce Willis in a early 90s action movie, the down on his look kind of gumshoe talking about how his wife left him. But it's so persistent that it's kind of obvious.
Like, okay, when's she going to show up?
Yeah. It's like, okay, this is clearly foreshadowing now and not just a character thing. So we see that Hunter has a moment with Skye where he suggests that Ward might be a way to find out about
Coulson's secrets. Like, proper LOL moment for me when Hunter goes, I was a fat baby, when he was looking at that picture. It was just
so
like,
random.
What a comment. Loved it.
And it's funny because it sort of occurred to me at the moment where she, you know, we get the obligatory... Hannibal Ward, you know, sort of Hannibal Lecter moment where she goes down to the sort of the basement to speak to him, that it kind of reminded me of late season one, where every so often you have an episode that reminds you of just how many plates are spinning story-wise.
Yeah.
You know, because you've got the rain and stuff, you've got the Whitehall, you've got the Brit Hill, you've got Hydra, you've got Coulson and the hieroglyphics, you know, and you've...
But they have this really uncanny way of bringing it all together coherently.
Yeah, exactly. And it's as though the one of the skills I think the writers team have got is exactly that you've just pointed out. But also just the fact that, you know, they've obviously sat down at the beginning of season two and started planning out the story arc. And they were kind of like, well, what have we got left over from season one? And they've introduced lots of new elements as well, like Mac and Hunter and Bobby and all this other stuff. And, you know, the new situation that this reduced S.H.I.E.L.D. have got. And they've obviously gone, okay, well, we've still got, you know, like General Talbot. We've still got Ward kind of here. We've got all of these things. So they've obviously just looked at them and gone, okay, well, how can we use these? We've got Rayna. How can we use these characters to service the storyline? And, you know, they've got, obviously, you know, Skye and her family and that mystery and all that kind of stuff. And the after effects of the serum that was used on Coulson and all that kind of stuff. So I just think that this is one of those episodes where, you know, it's not as much just fun as the rompier episodes, but it's an episode where it's moving a lot of pieces around the board.
Yeah.
And it always just impresses me, you know, and there's moments where you'll have all these different storylines going on and then you'll be like, oh, yeah, Ward as well. And then you remember that he's connected to Rayna and he knows this and knows that. And it's just...
I think that's why this episode felt so impressive for me because, you know, it would have been very easy for it to be a very heavy, dour episode, considering the serious nature of the storylines that's happening. And yet there is such a lightness and hopeful tone to it in lots of different ways. Like even just the introduction of Bobby and the brightness she brings in taking the piss out of Hunter.
Well, you never forget
it's not to be overlooked because it means that you want to keep watching it because you're not feeling like pulled down into a depressive hole.
It never forgets that it's based on comic books that were written for children.
Yeah.
And it was funny, I was having a sort of a discussion, I won't say argument because it was really civil, on the Chinstroker versus Punter page about Marvel and DC films with somebody. And it got to a point...
Oh, I saw that. Yeah.
And it got to a point where I was just like, look, we're not going to agree with each other. Mm. And also, you know, I was like, we're arguing about films about men in tights. And in fairness, the person who I was responding to was like, yeah, fuck we are, aren't we?
I saw that and I must admit, I thought, this is why I like the Chinstroker versus Punter page, because you get people disagreeing with each other all the time.
But there comes a point where we're like, you know what? These are only fucking films.
But I think the people on that page are really looking for that opposite opinion to have a proper discussion. Yeah.
Yeah, without it getting personal.
Yeah.
Because it is just, I mean, that's why, I mean, without getting into it too much, I enjoy the DC films to a certain extent, but there are moments where, you know, I was watching the new Justice League and it's like, it's over 4 hours long. And there was a moment where, you know, it was all very earnest and it was all very kind of like, you know, Superman was in the sky, kind of looking off, ruminating about what it's like to be a god. And it got to the point where I was like, guys, this is a fucking comic book.
Mm.
Just, you know, pull the stick out your ass. But
but don't worry, Ward, sticks are available.
Yes. Ward tells Sky that Rayna knows her dad.
Mm-hmm.
And obviously she is...
He went, she knows your dad.
Yeah, oh, yeah, she knows your dad. But it's...
just like that.
Yeah.
She knows your
dad. But... obviously, Sky, her concern, well, her suspicion is that Ward's just trying to find a way back in, you know?
Yeah.
And Ward said that he saw the carvings from Garrett, and he basically tells her that, look, you know, it shit gets real.
If someone's carving that stuff, yeah, they're going a bit bananas.
And also, from an audience perspective, what we're seeing is, again and again, what Ward is telling her is true.
Yeah.
You know,
so you start to believe it as well.
Yeah, yeah. So, I mean, regardless of his motivations for it, you know, that seems to be the case.
Yeah.
And he said that, and this is kind of where I think this is the eureka moment for Sky, is when Ward says that Garrett started acting that way when he was injected with the serum.
Yeah.
And she's like, well, okay, I know what the connection is now.
Yeah.
Or the catalyst for this.
Works out who's been making the carvings.
Yeah.
It's Coulson.
Yeah. And we see that Rayna sees Simmons and there's a sort of, I've got a little bit of leverage going on here now. Because she's really
She gets her evil smirk.
She does. And she's stuck between a rock and a hard place. So
she's like,
okay, this could be an out. I've got a bit of a, as George Costanza says, I have hand. You know, now all of a sudden. Sky confronts Coulson, and he basically sort of comes clean about the GH formula.
Yeah.
And about how basically they wanted to passively observe her because theoretically she should also be having the same thing happening.
And that potentially she's an alien.
Yeah, or I mean, has alien DNA, but she jumps to the conclusion, you know, what are you saying here? And
apologies, that's our dishwasher, if you can hear that.
Yeah, people are thinking, God, my stomach's really bad this week. So Rayna calls, phones up. We see that there's a mole hunt going on in Hydra, and we're introduced to the Adrian Palicki character, who at this point we get the impression that she's a Hydra sort of inquisitor.
I love how she is so, like, looking back on it, she's so over the top with the evil, like, you know, head slightly bent down but looking up.
Yeah.
Well,
she's taller than everyone else, which must be difficult for
yeah, but
for
like as her well, head but. Is angled towards the floor, but her eyes are angled up to give that almost like a sexy evil person.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And yeah, it was just like it was so comic book, I love that.
But also,
I think
it's consistent with the fact that
She's putting a persona on.
It's a signal to the audience. So we see this Inquisitor come in and the mole hunt begin. We see Simmons. Sort of snivelly colleague gets pegged. Yeah. But we don't feel bad for him because...
really excited about killing millions or billions of people.
Yeah. So we see Coulson meet Rayna in the restaurant. She threatens to expose Simmons as well. And
you think that he's on the back foot to start with.
Yeah, absolutely. And
which Sky thinks he is as well.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I think... I think at this point... this is hammering home that you, as an audience, you are Sky because you're seeing it through her eyes in terms of what you know. And I love how it's sort of revealed to her that actually, she needs to have better faith in Coulson that he's already thinking ahead of that.
That is, you're right, but I think it goes both ways. In a way, what it also shows is that if Coulson had let her in, then May wouldn't be having to deal with the difficult situation of Skye wanting to go. Yeah. And Skye does disappear and go off. Now, fortunately, because Kyle MacLachlan's character is already gone, there's no bad side effects from that. But it's another example of Coulson not appearing to not trust Skye and how that can push her away into the arms of danger. And, you know,
well,
kind
there,
of like,
there is a bad side effect from it in that, you know, up until that point, Skye's father has not wanted anything to do with Daniel Whitehall. But when he sees Skye hugging Coulson, he gets jealous.
Yeah, yeah.
So it does have a bad
impact. I suppose it does. It does in the long run. And so we see Simmons getting sort of pressured by the seemingly evil Adrian Pilecki. So we learn that Raina wants to take Skye with her. This is back to in the restaurant. Yeah. And she puts a 2-minute countdown on the phone, which is where we see Skye start to freak out when Raina mentions that she wants her to take her to meet her dad.
If this was a Naked Gun version of it, I feel like it would have got to 0 and then just started again at 2. Or like she would have reset it and gone, I'll just give you 2 more minutes.
I'll never forget.
She really looked like she wanted to.
What this reminded me of was, There's several moments. I wish I'd mentioned this. I did a podcast episode a while ago at Hannah's suggestion, which was kind of formative experiences from films, like bits of moments from films that have shaped you or that you really remember. And I'll never forget watching a James Bond film. It was a Sean Connery one when I was a kid watching it with my parents on TV. And there's the classic bomb ticking sort of down from 60 to 0.
Yeah.
And he's trying to decide where he's going to cut the red wire. And when he cuts it, it stops, and the countdown stops on 007. And I just remember thinking, that is so fucking cool. I was like 7 or something like that. But easily impressed. So Raina intimates that Skye was taken from her dad against his will. Mm-hmm. And Coulson basically just doesn't budge and says no deal. May won't let Skye leave as well. There's a bit of a kerfuffle going on kind of behind the velvet rope there. Coulson lets the file transfer happen. And of course, we as the audience are like, Phil, what are you doing, man? You know, Phil, man, what are you... the fuck? And
I love it when you get worried.
Yeah. No, that was my... the voice I was doing there was, there's a line from Biker Grove that I always remember.
Is that your Geordie accent?
Yeah, it was like, I always remember the line where... PJ or Duncan, Geordie. I can't remember which fucking one. It's just because, Jeff, man, you've got pie in your beard. I always remember that. Jeff, man, you've got pie in your beard. I heard that once in like 1996, and my brain has been carrying that around every day since. So whenever I'm panicking or in a hip situation, I'm like, Phil, man.
That's hilarious.
I also like the fact that Adrian Pilecki's character is doing... It's almost like they're taking the piss out of Black Widow.
Yeah.
Like the way that they're framing it, and she's doing the sort of... pulling
smiling,
the things from behind her back.
I'm going to fucking kick your ass.
Yeah, I'm in a white corridor wearing black. I know this looks cool kind of thing. And we see that... So basically it becomes apparent very quickly that Coulson has a plan, after all.
Look what I've written. Coulson has a plan.
Yeah. Phil, man. So he figures that Skye's father has the obelisk and that Raina is scared. Mm-hmm. And she's basically saying, look, please take me in. It's a kind of like I need
protection.
No, there's a particular word. It always happened in Star Trek when somebody would be able to ship in a... It's not sanctuary. I don't know. Like
refugee?
No, forget it. I'll remember it at 4 o'clock this morning when I'm going for like my third piss of the night. So they tag her.
Don't wake me up.
We see Bobby Morse, who we learn is Bobby Morse, mm-hmm. Striking the hero poses, and they jump onto a cloaked ship. I like the fact that this completely proves my whole Simmons is Willow thing. You know how I said the whole... Because she's like, I like
absolutely.
You.
Absolutely.
And it's like she's telling the audience it's okay to
it's
like
okay
this character.
It's okay to like you. Yeah.
You know, it's, like I say, it's the old Willow trick. They see the sky's gone and they're like, whoops. I mean, I'm surprised they actually took their eyes off her, but I suppose they've been very busy. Mm. They go and they find the aftermath of Carl McLachlan's sort of deranged antics.
Do you think if we ever lost our children, we could just say that to the police? We've been very busy.
yeah, that's it. It's like, what a hell of a week.
Sorry, we've been very busy.
Very busy. And then we get that moment that you Rich referenced earlier on where Coulson hugs Skye and we see that they're being watched by Carl McLachlan.
And that picture that she finds on the floor, I put a note that it looks like either a headshot or a behind-the-scenes cast picture from Twin Peaks.
Yeah, yeah.
It just has that look about it.
I like the fact that when he turns up, Hunter's slightly pissed because he's been drinking wine at the restaurant. That's a nice little touch.
Yeah.
And she's like, what is your cover, Ron Burgundy? And we see that the bodies have been left behind, so the implication or the conclusion that they, particularly Skye, jumps to is that he's this monstrous, murderous kind of figure.
Yeah.
Bobby joins the team. Fitz and Simmons are reunited.
And Simmons, sorry, I just wanted to give mention to the bit where Simmons whispers, she's amazing.
Oh, yeah, she's kind of fangirling a little bit.
She's got a complete girl crush, yeah. I love it. It kind of, like you say, it cements the fact that Bobby's a good character. Yeah.
And it's those little touches that make
Well, then she goes on to sort of, you find out that actually she knows Mac really well, and you realise that all the you know, bad talk that Hunter's been doing about his ex and all this kind of stuff, that they've basically just been humouring him and they know who he's been talking about,
yes.
And they don't feel the same way about it. Yeah. And they sort of see Hunter for who he is and love him anyway,
yeah.
Kind of thing.
And they probably know that he doesn't actually really mean it.
He doesn't really mean it, yeah.
Bravado.
Yeah.
And so Fitz and Simmons are reunited. He says, is that really you? And she's like, well, you know, what do you mean by that? Of course it is. Coulson agrees to be more sharing of information with Skye in future. And Skye comes to the conclusion that these scratchings are a map. And then we finish out with Carl McLachlan coming to Whitehall, taking him what he calls the Diviner.
Yep.
That we've been calling the Obelisk up until this point. And he says, I'll teach you how to survive and we'll work together to kill him. And that's such a Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D.-esque delivery, the way it's like, yes, we'll kill him and, oh, I don't know, everyone else.
Mm.
You know, that's that kind of, it's like the Whedon kind of, Buffy's gravestone said she saved the world a lot. You know,
yeah.
It's that kind of
vibe.
Okay, well, we'll do a quick sum up and then we'll maybe do a quick spoiler section. I'm not expecting to have that much in the way of spoilers for this one,
to be honest.
I haven't got
any spoilers.
We'll skip the spoiler section then, because I don't really have that much. The only thing I've got really is to go into a little bit more detail about...
I've maybe got one thing, but it's not something we have to talk about.
No, okay. We'll bypass the spoiler section this week and maybe save it up and...
I think basically because this episode was more about... For me, it sort of made me think this was the episode where they're just reminding you that they still have a sense of humour in all of this seriousness.
Yeah.
They've still got... It's still Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D.
Well, I think
like,
also what they're
worry.
Doing, though, is it's not even necessarily that it's moving the storyline along, but what this episode does is it clarifies different characters' relationships with elements of the story in the way that it's like, right, okay, this character's relationship with the story is this.
Mm.
This character's relationship to the plot is this.
Yeah.
And it's kind of... It's a chess kind of episode. But,
For sure.
But so, Anna, final thoughts? Like Jerry Springer?
Really, really enjoyed this. Like I said, I was surprised at the lightness of touch and just relieved to remember how good it was this early on.
Yeah.
You know, and pleased that I haven't misremembered it, I suppose. Loving this rewatch, and this episode was, you know, another one that just felt really great.
But do you feel like they have congealed into a team yet, Hannah?
Fuck me. Yes, they're a team. I'm going to stop talking about it.
No, but it's funny, though, because what a lot of TV shows do, particularly these network shows with longer seasons, and you see this in Buffy and a lot of shows, Fringe did this as well, is you often start the season with the team separated.
Yeah.
And the status quo upset. The status is not quo at the beginning of the season.
So
and,
not quo.
This is the episode where everybody's reconnected. It's like the status is quo. Again, after this.
I think the only reason I mention that is because, you know, I'm a podcast listener. You know, I'm first and foremost rather than a podcaster. Mm-hmm. And I tend to listen to stuff on repeat a lot. I'm currently re-listening to a whole bunch of Answer Me This mm-hmm. episodes. And something like one of the people in the show repeating the same thing over and over would absolutely do my head in.
Oh, all podcasters do it though.
But yeah, so I'm just apologising, and I didn't mean to, and I'm very sorry, and please don't.
Well,
stop
the other
listening.
Thing is as well is you can't, you don't know how closely people listen to podcasts because
yeah.
we all consume podcasts differently. For a lot of people, it's just white noise while they're cleaning that they drift in and out of.
Yeah,
you know. So I think a lot of the time, on Tuesday Stroke of O Spencer, I'll repeat stuff, knowing I'm repeating it. But I don't know whether somebody has heard that before.
Yeah.
You know? I mean, obviously there's a limit, but I wouldn't beat yourself up too much. While I'm going through the various bits of housekeeping, could you just bring up the details of next week's episode?
Of course.
So it's just another reminder to go over to wearepodsyndicate.com. Also, emails are always welcome. Thanks again to Millie for emailing today.
Yes, thank you, Millie.
So more of those, please. That'd be great, guys. We want to know who you are. You can hear us, so we'd like to be able to hear or read you. And you can do that via rewatchprojectpodcast@gmail.com or by hitting the plus message sign over at our anchor.fm page. And we are also on Twitter at rewatchproj. So, what's the next episode of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D.?
So episode 6 is called A Fractured House. Synopsis says, the world turns against S.H.I.E.L.D. when Hydra impersonates them to attack the United Nations, and an unexpected enemy leads the charge to bring about their downfall. The episode is directed by Ron Underwood, and it is written by Rafe Judkins and Lauren LeFranc.
Cool. Okay. Well, we will see you then, guys. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Is part of the Pod Syndicate family. For more criminally compelling shows, articles, and conversations, head to wearepodsyndicate.com.